Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Institute of World Politics. I'm happy you could make it. We'll be talking about doomed soldiers in case of Poland, unlike in most other places in the old Soviet bloc. These were also anti-Nazi soldiers. There is a continuity between the anti-German and the anti-Soviet and anti-communist insurgency in Poland. We've already had a few presentations before concerning doomed soldiers. First one was strictly historical. I showed you maps, or showed maps, narrated historical facts, pictures, including secret police souvenir pictures of dead doomed soldiers. The next one we covered concerned communist propaganda and doomed soldiers. We showed Andrzej Wajda's movie called Diamonds and Ashes as an example of anti-communist propaganda. Today, it will be a little bit unusual, for we will talk just a tiny bit about doomed soldiers, and most of our presentation will concern the way that they are remembered today. Now, I had a lecture which was devoted mostly to soccer fans and soccer hooligans and their commemorations of everything anti-communist, everything anti-Nazi, and Polish history. Here, the phenomenon has bloomed to unbelievable proportions. Let me beat my own drum first. Okay. This book, which was basically written in 1990, waited for 4 years to be published, and then it was self-published in quote-unquote free Poland because no mainstream or any other publisher was interested. This is one of the first books about the doomed soldiers. I wrote it, so I'm beating my own drum. It's called The National Armed Forces, Major Tooth Against Two Enemies. No interest whatsoever among the post-communists and others who control the media and the publishing business to bring it out and share the story with the population, with the public, with the reading public. So it was self-published in 1994. It took another 5 years until 1999 for a publisher to put it out in an academic form. This one lacks any footnotes because it's just there was no money for it. That one is basically the same thing with footnotes. Okay. Just brief history. This is these are insufficient maps because the insurgency from the very start was a rolling insurrection, and it was launched in January 1944, the minute the Soviets crossed the pre-war Polish frontier. It was called Operation Tempest. The idea for the pro-Western Polish independentist underground was to liberate swaths of Poland incrementally as the Nazis were fleeing or retreating. The underground engaged them, killed them, sometimes on its own, sometimes jointly with the Red Army. But once the Soviets solidified their grip and power in a given area, they would liquidate the Polish government authorities, because everywhere there were, everywhere starting from Volhynia, there were Polish civilian authorities, underground civilian authorities, which emerged. starting with Vilno area, there were there was the police and military authorities. So the Soviet secret police arrested them, shot some of them, deported many to Siberia on the Gulag, and impressed the rank and file forcibly of the underground into the Polish Communist Army under Soviet control. When the Soviets moved in January 1945, so a year after the Operation Tempest commenced and culminated in the Warsaw Uprising, the ill-fated Warsaw Uprising. So when the Soviet army moved west, the insurgency restarted spontaneously without an order from above this time. Simply, local commanders rejoined battle, re-emerged from the underground, reassembled their units, and attacked all communist assets. Basically, the communist power was limited to major cities, and that only during the daytime. At night, they were only safe in garrisons, secret police headquarters, and other fortified points. Everything else was in the hands of the insurgents. And the insurgency went on all over Poland, but also outside of Vilno. There was still Polish underground as late as 1946 in what became the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, but it didn't have insurgent units in the forest because Ukrainian nationalists had been fighting a war of extermination against the Polish population and Polish underground. So it was extremely hard to maintain anything in the lands of the Ukraine in the forest. However, not so much in what became the Belarusian Soviet Socialist Republic and the Lithuanian Soviet Socialist Republic. There, the Polish underground continued as it had against the Germans and indeed as it had against the Soviets from the very start. The insurgency, of course, was first thwarted and crushed in what used to be Eastern Poland or Eastern Commonwealth lands. The last home army patrol, really, the last unit was destroyed by the NKVD in 1949 outside of Vilno, and the last patrol in 1953. By that time, in what became People's Poland, the once robust battalion size, sometimes regiment size, outfits were reduced to patrols. They broke up and operated as patrols, 3 to 5 people, for tactical reasons. They built bunkers, they were hiding among the people, they continued their insurgency. The insurgency ceased for all purposes in 1956. I think probably the last symbolic attack of the insurgents on the communist police station took place in March 1957 outside of Białystok. It was my friend's uncle who led the attack. Major Tabortowski Bruzda was his code name. And he was killed in that attack. There were a few, even after 1956, and 1956 was a huge watershed because the communists announced an amnesty, a final amnesty for the insurgents, so some revealed themselves. But a few stalwarts were still waiting for World War III, for the Americans to come to Poland to liberate them, and they held out. For instance, the secret police and special operations police captured an insurgent on December 31st, 1961, in the forest of Janów, in his bunker. So his nickname was Leśniczy. He has not been exonerated by the post-communist courts until this very day. Yes, because the courts are independent in Poland. The last insurgent to be killed perished in the field in 1963. A formidable individual engaged the Nazis and the communists from 1939. He was in the underground and he switched to guerrilla units. And afterwards he refused to break his oath. Why? Well, I suspect because he was of an elite unit of the Polish army before the war. Namely, he was a bodyguard to the President of the Republic. Those people took themselves seriously. Just because he was a corporal, it doesn't mean that that person had no honor. On the contrary, those people were really hardcore. Once he swore an oath, he was a soldier, that was it. Okay. By the way, just as a way of comparison, please keep in mind that the KGB killed the last Estonian insurgent in the field in 1978. I have pictures if you're interested. The last Ukrainian insurgent was discovered or emerged from hiding. He had been hiding in his sister's attic after 1990. And in Romania, the last insurgent was captured, I think, in 1971 and put in jail. His unit had been destroyed in 1959. So those are lone wolves who wouldn't have survived without local support, very secret local support. And they were all captured ultimately because of snitches in the local community. Now, little did I know that by working to restore the hidden history of Poland, I'd contribute. I'm not going to be modest. Nobody was doing it. There was just a little tiny group doing it. And when I came from the US, there were a couple, so three, four, five people, and we all worked on restoring the memory of those people who fought against them, both the Nazis and the communists. Right now, it's actually pop cultural fashion. The kids love heroes. Nobody morally relativistic, squishy. They love those who fight. So the kids and the grassroots have embraced them with a gusto. This year is really the first year when the government of the Polish Republic wholeheartedly supports such commemorations. And just to be on a funny side, since this year the government in Warsaw organized the main celebrations, everybody assumed the weather was horrible, so that people would go see the government show. No, the grassroots, not as many as there came to the government celebration, but the grassroots still gathered in the old place. And they marched independently. Why? Because they don't like to be dictated. That's their holiday. They make the posters. They remember the heroes. That's how the grassroots feel. So you have posters here. National Day to commemorate doomed soldiers. The symbol of the wolf comes from a poem by Zbigniew Herbert. He who lived like a wolf and perished. And you have a few faces. Bartek was a pilot, a combat pilot, who later in Cieszyn Silesia led underground units against the Nazis and communists. He was foolish, for he accepted a communist amnesty. And when he revealed himself, he was killed while getting a shave at the local barbers. His soldiers were lured into a trap by the secret police, a famous sham operation. They were all picked up. The communists, who pretended to be operators of the Polish government in exile, told them they were taking them to hook up with the Americans. This was in 1946. They were taken to somewhere in Silesia. Their food was spliced with a narcotic. They fell asleep and the structure was blown up. So about 200, 170 or so. They're still unaccounted for and missing in action. Lalek, this guy right here, is the last to be killed in 63. Inka was a combat medic in a unit of a, she was 17 years old when the communists sentenced her to death. Her crime was that she patched up a communist policeman after a firefight. And later he recognized her on the street when she came to town to buy medicine. Witold, this is Dorotka Optułowicz's grandfather, my sister's best friend's grandfather. He volunteered for Auschwitz to find out what the Germans were up to. He is the source of first reports, including about the Holocaust. Later, he escaped from Auschwitz. He fought in the Warsaw Uprising. He was taken prisoner, survived the Oflag, escaped, joined the Polish army in the West, in Italy, and then volunteered on a reconnaissance mission to Soviet-occupied Poland. He was captured and executed as a spy for the Vatican and the U.S., one of the greatest heroes of World War II. Then you have other soldiers. And here is my favorite. This is my family from Vilnius, Lithuania now. These are the brigades or a spearhead of Major Łupaszko's Vilno Brigade. This is all now in public sphere. People in Poland didn't even know how those humans looked like, those heroes. They had no idea because they had been brainwashed by the communists. Hence the moniker, doomed soldiers. The communists hid their graves and they made sure everybody forgot. These are all grassroots pictures and posters. Everybody is supposed to remember. Please notice that this one on the left, that one is from Gdynia. And one of the sponsors, on the left you have the Union of the Soldiers of the National Armed Forces. On the right you have the fans of Arka Gdynia soccer club, which during Solidarity was one of the most stalwart outfits to fight the communist riot police. So they love this. They say, we continue into their footsteps. Boys and girls want to be just like these people. You have another poster here calling to commemorate officially on March the 1st. March the 1st. And you have, again, a variety of heroes. Here's a friend of my family. He jumped with my great uncle, September 1942. He was dropped from a British plane as a commando. He was killed by the communists. He fought the Nazis. He was killed by the communists. Here, Oleg died battling the NKVD outside of Vilno in 1949. He was Orthodox by faith, a teacher, and identified himself as a Polish officer. We have their faces. We have restored the histories. And now the kids have decided to commemorate them spontaneously. And this is what happened when Polish paramilitaries and reenactors bump into a US Army unit. And they commemorate together. You see, both boys and girls. That means it's the Rifleman organization. It's a paramilitary, voluntary, self-defense organization. That is yet another tradition that we've resurrected. Territorial self-defense. And they demand that the communist laws be overturned and that the population could arm itself. Just in case. So I'll play an unusual video for you. By the way, this is not, most of it is not in the public sphere, in the public realm. It's not in the public realm. It's we may, I don't know if it's still there. Oh, this is in Polish. Oh, you got it? Oh, good. Hey, it's still there. Skip ad. Okay. I don't know where the. It's a 17-year-old Polish paramilitary kid. So you have to, I'm showing it to you so you would know that it's not all serious, it's also fun and games. Okay. Okay. Next one. All right. There is a new there's been a new development for a couple of years now. Maria calls it keeping the wolf struck, following the wolf struck or tracking the wolves. Namely, people run. They have marathons and shorter distance runs to commemorate those who are fallen. This is replete with history shows, and it's full of reenactors. They run, but they also march. Here is, I'm not showing Warsaw and major cities on purpose so you wouldn't think that this is somehow centrally generated. It's not. Little places like this. Here's Tygodnik Kampiński. Podziemie niepodległościowe w powiecie kampińskim. Grassroots people start doing it. They are no longer afraid. Took 25 years not to be afraid. They dig out pictures and they talk about their heroes who fought the Germans, the Soviets, and native communists. It's unbelievable. Let's have another march in a small place. Piła is not a major city. Okay. Sorry, the PowerPoint way didn't work. No, that's not this. Don't worry. Anyway. You have to. Would you like me to try? They have been YouTubed, but they are not really in public realm because they are little private films. No, don't do it here, do it here. If you do it here, it won't show what you want. Yes. No. Okay. I thought you were going to click.
The link doesn't work.
Oh, the link doesn't work?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. That's it? They're chanting God, honor, and motherland. As you see, the participants are rather young. Well, young people usually don't like to hear the word compromise. And they are chanting glory to heroes. I'll explain about the banners in a second. Yes. Well, as I said, we had one lecture where I played reggae music in favor of doomed soldiers. They have all kinds of genre, rap, classical, poetic, you name it, and reggae to commemorate those people. Now you have, okay. Can I turn it off? Here, okay. All right. Okay. Śmierć wrogom ojczyzny. Death to the enemies of motherland. This was actually a tab, an epaulet, a badge on the shoulders of the soldiers of the 5th Vilno Brigade of the Home Army and the National Military Union. So these kids thought it's really cool. And I'll show you at the very end how cool they think it is. It's not going to go away. It is a part of history. It is a part of tradition. And it has generated reenactors. There are people dressing up as the heroes. This is Gdańsk 2016. And it's really incredible, for it involves all sorts of gadgets and reenacting. Do you know what this is? It should be a self-propelled gun called Ferdinand, which the insurgents captured from the Germans during the Warsaw Uprising. The insurgent group was the Chata 49 Battalion. Of course, they have a tank. I told them it was a self-propelled gun that they captured from the Germans. But they have a tank and painted it the way they wanted to paint it, and that's it. And they're all dressed apart, please. Note, this is an insurgent unit in full uniform, just like they were back then. And here's Chata 49. Guess what? A local high school took that name. One of the most valiant insurgent units. And you have guys dressed up as insurgents marching in Gdańsk. Here is another insurgent unit. Please note, they also have included the uniforms of the Polish Army in the West. This is General Maciek's troops. 1st Armored Division. Polish 1st Armored Division that fought in Normandy at Falaise. It closed the Falaise Gap. The communists hated their guts. We have them back. Everybody is back in nature as it should be. And you have the insurgents. And you have the real insurgents. Why? Because the kids, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, soccer fans invite the dinosaurs to participate. And they cherish them. They listen to their stories. They can't get enough of them. It is Poznań, 2013. Not Warsaw. Here's Wrocław. All of this is spontaneous. They organize themselves through social media. And soccer hooligan clubs conclude a ceasefire, truce. They don't beat each other up on those days. Because normally, yes, in America, we always think, oh, it must be racism. People beat each other up because someone is black. No, no, no. When everybody's white, they just beat each other up because people root for different teams. And here, whenever the kids observe and commemorate the heroes, no violence. Under the liberal government, the police would attack the kids, so there would be violence. But otherwise, discipline and no violence. The reenacting goes a long way. Here is a scene from Wrocław. And I actually have pictures from that local publication. That's her being tortured. Her. 19-year-old. And her. This is a reenactment of an NKVD woman questioning a Polish communist secret policeman torturing. And here's her execution. Reenacted exactly as it was. Thousands gather to watch it. They go to jail. Outside of jail, there are names of heroes inscribed. Heroes killed by the communists. This is Warsaw, 2016. The kids come. Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts keep watch, no matter what weather it is. On that day, and not only. Look at the reenactors, just like in the insurgent units. There was no diversity or gender quotas. In Poland, women fight. That's just the way it is. It was, and hopefully it won't be, because it won't be necessary. They read the role of the fallen heroes, name by name. And those who gather chant, they are with us. They remember. Okay, now I will be rather unorthodox. Since in California one can study underwater basket weaving, I decided to tell you the story of doomed soldiers, not only with traditional PowerPoint, but also with, ladies and gentlemen, thank you, t-shirts. Here is probably, pardon the appearance, my wife wants to toss it, one of the first t-shirts. It says Gun for Hire. This t-shirt was made to commemorate my commanding officer. When I was young and beautiful, I volunteered for Afghanistan. He was to, Rafa was to be the commanding officer of that outfit in Afghanistan. And President Reagan said, Marek, Stingers, we'll send Stingers. So I'm alive, nothing happened, everything's fine. This guy, when he was Rafał Ganganowicz, when he was 13, the Germans killed his mom, bombing Warsaw in 1939. His father was in the underground as a second lieutenant. By the way, this is a Polish Tatar family which returned from Brazil to fight against the Bolsheviks in 1920 because they had gotten in trouble under the Tsar and had to flee. In any event, Rafał's father took him to the Warsaw Uprising in 1944 against the Nazis. And the father was killed. Rafał was then, he was born in 1930, so when his mom was killed, he was 9. In the Warsaw Uprising, he was 14. Rafał rejoined the underground, but for a few years after the war, he limited himself to painting slogans on the wall. Around 1947-48, the communist secret police, since there was Sovietization and a complete crackdown, began shooting kids who were tagging walls. And remember, most of those kids were street urchins and war orphans. And there were plenty of weapons after World War II, so they started shooting back. That went on until 1950, when Rafał's group got busted. He was warned on his way home. He picked up 2 Colt revolvers that had been hidden by him, headed to the station, hopped on a train, laid under the carriage, traveled west with a little bit of problems, he crossed the border, fooling the guards, emerged in Berlin, reported to the Americans, turned his weapons over. He was vetted and transferred to the commando training center of the Polish army, which worked with U.S. military intelligence. He was commissioned as second lieutenant upon graduation. He was slated to be the first wave. When President Eisenhower promised rollback and liberation, Rafa was ready to go. Unfortunately, in 1956, the West and the Soviets kissed and made up on the bloody body of Hungary, plus nuclear weapons prevented us from liberating all those people, because that would have meant suicide. And Rafał was left to ply his trade, which was French literature. He became a high school teacher of French literature. However, Congo went up in flames, and the communists were meddling there. So Rafa walked into Moses Chombe's embassy in Belgium, in Brussels, and said, "Hey, I'm Polish. We never had colonies. I hate communists. I want your people to be free. And the communists are going to enslave you." So he volunteered, and Moses Chombe's ambassador flew him out and other Poles who fought the communists in the Congo. Rafał almost got Che Guevara. Oh yes, Che fled. By the way, here's my favorite picture. It's called Chedolf. This also shows you popular culture in Poland, which is the opposite of politically correct. If you can pass it on, that would be great. It's a serious periodical of history. On the opposite side, you have Che Guevara's face with all the victims he personally executed. So, Rafał fought in the Congo. His commanding officer was Bob Denard. Any one of you who is interested in the Cold War, maybe read Frederick Forsyth's Dogs of War, that was Bob Denard. Afterwards, Rafał served in Yemen as an employee of the King of Saudi Arabia. His two most famous deeds were shooting down the top Soviet advisor in his MiG, and the plane didn't explode. It just dumped itself into the desert with a dead Soviet in full uniform and documents. So the royal ambassador at the United Nations proved that Brezhnev's denials to the country, the Soviets were involved in Yemen. Rafał's other stupendous deed was after he received a fatwa permitting him to mortar the Soviet embassy that was adjacent to an ancient 15th century mosque. He did so without touching the mosque. So the mosque was undamaged, but he leveled the Soviet embassy. He mortared it and howitzered it. And then he lobbed a few into the French embassy. I asked why, and he said, "For Yalta." And I said, "But the French weren't there. So why did they recognize the communist regime?" Anyway, he was a character. Then he supported Solidarity in fighting Solidarity, became a journalist with Radio Free Europe. I talked about him. Nobody believed me. In the People's Republic of Poland, of course, after 1989. So finally, we convinced him to come. We said, "Hey, why don't you give up your weapons and tell the police that you're now emerging from the underground and you promise to be a productive citizen?" Nobody really cared. The communist and post-communist media mocked him. However, the kids loved him. When he died, we didn't have money to bury him. Hence the t-shirt. The t-shirt sold. And now he has a tombstone. Sold very well. In fact, it was one of the first ones with that theme. Here's another one. This is the anchor, or PW, is a sign of fighting Poland. That's the Polish anti-Nazi, anti-communist underground. That's soul, that sells like crazy. I have lots of people wearing this. There are more specific t-shirts too, with patriotic themes. Here's one I got when I marched with the riflemen, reenacting Joseph Piłsudski's march in 1914. This is the rifleman organization Eagle. And look what it says on the back. I believe on May 3rd, 1939, Poland's foreign minister responded to Adolf Hitler as follows. You want us to surrender and give you our land? There's only one thing in the life of people, nations, and states. One thing that is priceless, and that thing is honor. And that was the answer of Poland to Adolf Hitler and Joseph Stalin. The kids wear those t-shirts. Imagine if we had t-shirts with the utterances of our founding fathers, which we should. Here, let me dig it out. Here's one of the most popular t-shirts. National Armed Forces. They were equal opportunity killers, Nazis and communists, with no discrimination from the very beginning. They said Poland has two enemies, Stalin and Hitler. Hitler and Stalin. Not enemy number one and enemy under number two, just whoever wants our independence and freedom is the enemy, the National Armed Forces. By the way, the name of the company, which is a grassroots company by very young people, is Red is Bad. I said, guys, that means red is cool. Make it Red is Evil, but since it's branded now, it's too late. It's a Polish company, so it's in Polish, not in English. Here. Okay. Here is a specific t-shirt from reenactment. My kids started going to a place called Machinets because the 5th and 6th Vilno Brigades fought one of the greatest battles of the anti-communist insurgency in 45, destroying the NKVD. What happened was the Soviet secret police and Polish communist secret police arrested a couple of wounded insurgents and they tortured them. So the local people ran to alarm the superior officers to come to the rescue. And Major Łupaszka, who's now, I'm sorry, the government has just promoted him to Lieutenant Colonel Zygmunt Szendzielos, who was a friend of my grandmother and my grandfather from before the war, and they fought together in the wartime. He ordered all his units to converge from Kadzidło, Ostrołęka, Pułtusk, Myszyniec, and they all converged, destroyed the communists, freed the prisoners, and everything was well. Here is a replica of an original stamp of an insurgent unit. At first, those were all homemade. Now, it's commercialized. It's pop culture. It's unbelievable. I've seen this morphing, changing in 25 years. The post-communists, liberals and others, other enemies of truth, made sure this would never surface. They impeded any research, stigmatized anybody who touched anything, and attempted to keep it from the public. But it's unstoppable. And it spawns a variety of other themes. For instance, even though this is not about the doomed soldiers, this is one of the proudest t-shirts anybody would like to wear. This is the symbol of the Kosciuszko squadron, 303, the highest scoring squadron in the Battle of Britain, Royal Air Force's Polish wing. My foster father was in 304. Royal Air Force's Polish wing. Patriotic t-shirts are all the rave at a variety of levels. I'll show you. Here's a t-shirt, brand new. I'll unpack it for you. This one actually says Doomed Soldiers. And what do you have? The 5th Vilno Home Army, National Military Organization Brigade. Cześć i chwała bohaterom, victory. These are the names of the fallen. Incredible, huh? History in t-shirts. This isn't the only one. Here, I'll take out. Here's one my daughter wears. She is a winged Polish hussar. That's very popular too. Now she's not gonna wear it unless, ladies and gentlemen, Dada wears it. Cause she's a big girl and she wants to wear the same thing that Dada does. Yes. Now, I don't want you to think this is somehow eccentric and silly and Polish, just to provide a frame of reference to those of you who are American patriots. How is that? But it's from here. Huh? Yes. Gun owners of America, we don't compromise. You shouldn't either. Guns kill people, then pencils misspell words. Cars make people drive drunk. Spoons made Rosie O'Donnell fat. Crickets, I know. It's a very similar sentiment. This is Stalowa Wola, again, local initiative. A local son who's an incredible sculptor. Andrzej Pityński, he lives in New York, New Jersey, set up a monument in his, well, near his place of birth, of a winged knight. It's called the Patriot. So they made t-shirts locally. Now, this is incredible because under communism, of course, nobody had any t-shirts or nobody made any t-shirts. And ladies and gentlemen, all of this has ushered in, oh, would you like to see more American doomed soldiers? The original Homeland Security. Yes. And here's stuff religiously themed, which is patriotic. See this? God save the Queen. Polish kids in England wear it. I saw this in London, actually, before I saw it anywhere else. Fronda is a Catholic publication of young people, young intellectuals. And here is Archangel Michael smashing Satan. The battle of good and evil. Nobody's shy in Poland. And of course, Alpha and Omega, Christ leading crusaders. For obvious reasons, it's a popular one. If you're really hardcore, here's the Inquisitor for you. It's almost predictable what the kids will wear. They will wear the opposite of what's on TV and in so-called mainstream media. Yes. And it's not only Polish or American themed. You know this t-shirt? And what it says? An pasado? Well, when during the civil war in Spain, the whites won over the reds, the crowds chanted, "They have passed." Because the communist slogan was the fist salute, no pasarán, they shall not pass. They have passed the cross triumph over a star. And Polish kids wear it. Spaniards who saw that in Poland freak out frequently because they have nothing like this at home. They're all ashamed of having fought in La Cruzada, in the crusade against Stalin. In any event, this is now a counter-cultural pop phenomenon. It has taken on enormous dimensions. It became a tradition of its own to commemorate, remember. And this is an indispensable element of any nation to think about those who sacrificed their lives for freedom, because that is exactly what these people, doomed soldiers, did. They didn't think the war was over just because Roosevelt, Churchill, and Stalin said so. The war is never over until there is freedom. And freedom came after 1989. So now they can be remembered. The secret police sometimes buried their bodies under septic tanks. You see? There are kids who, since 1989, have been in business of digging them out and giving them a proper burial, giving closure to their families. So Poland's now putting itself back together, just as other countries that experienced communist occupation. I think we should applaud it. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be glad to field them. Mr. Chop, how nice to see you.
Very nice. Thank you for the workshop. Lord, you're welcome. Happy to be here. Recently, Dr. Małgorzata Kaczorowska was lecturing in New York metropolitan area on her...
Obława Augustowska.
Exactly. She wrote a letter to Poland's ambassador to the United States, Richard Schnepp, asking Ambassador Schnepp if among the Schnepp family papers there are any papers that his father, Maximilian, who was a lieutenant in the NKVD, Maximilian
Schnepp.
Schnepp was born in Ukraine, came from a Jewish family background, and served in the NKVD, and participated in the...
August of Dragnet.
Yes, in the killing of Armia Krajowa soldiers, the Polish Army soldiers, in the woods in Augusto, in what is today northeastern Poland. Many of those graves have not yet been discovered. Based on your work on this topic, is it likely that Ambassador Schnepp's father may have among his papers any indication of where these soldiers are buried, Polish soldiers are buried in Poland?
Well, Mr. Chop, if you're interested, you can go to the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. His deposition is available. And if you'd like to know the details, talk to my assistant, who's read the deposition. But what I can tell you for sure is that the Dragnet, Augustów Dragnet, in which Maximilian Schnepp participated, netted seven or 8,000 people, out of which about 1,500 were executed. We don't have their bodies, and I would very much like their bodies because my grandfather's two cousins, two Chodakiewiczes, were among the underground fighters who were snatched. So it is in my family interest to get Ambassador Schnepp to spit out whatever he has in his closet. We just would like to bury our relatives. That's as simple as that. I don't even think that he was aware of anything much, to tell you the truth. These were children raised in comfort of communism, and generally speaking, they were not told about the astonishing success of their parents. We can have a separate lecture and you would be shocked to discover who is who. Even Poland's most popular TV show, which ran many years, about an NKVD agent called Stawka Większa Niż Życie, was written by a secret police snitch who made his career on denouncing people who would be then shot by the communists. So he was a writer for the secret police and he became a script writer for TV. That was a typical career path in totalitarianism. And the star of the show participated in assassination squads because his father was a secret police officer and he, as a teenager, participated in kidnapping and murdering democratic politicians. Yes. So Ambassador Schnepp is a minor problem in comparison to how deep totalitarian roots are spread in post-communism. And Poland's the best of all the countries because, obviously, I've poked around everywhere. Russia is the most toxic. Yes. Well, anyway, any other questions? Yes, sir.
I'd like to ask a question. Typically in the United States, at least according to my knowledge, we tend to draw a line between the positives of patriotism and the negatives of nationalism.
Uh-huh.
Do you think there, at any point in this movement, there's been more patriotism, or would you, in borrowing from the kind of lexicon of the United States, or would you think that there are elements to the movement that you just talked about today about that are more nationalistic?
Well, it's hard to quantify. Extremists are easily noticeable. I'll give you an example. It takes years to dig out, first of all find, then dig out the bones of the heroes, find the families, take DNA samples. There's no press coverage, no help to speak of. There hasn't been until recently. But it's enough that when the kids stage a demonstration against terrorism, and the kids, I mean all Polish youth, meaning high schoolers and university students, college students, and then a bozo shows up who's into his 50s and burns a Jew in effigy, then everybody covers it. Every single TV station, every single news outlet. And then there's the very same kids who spend years and their younger and older siblings, years digging for bodies, doing good work, never hear a good word. But some bozo shows up who's not one of them and burns a Jew in effigy. The result is, whoo, nationalism, they're Polish Nazis, anti-Semitism, blah, 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 God knows what else. So yes, it's very hard to draw a line. And the less... And the more opprobrium there is about what is perceived as threatening, the more hardcore they become. Because they think, okay, it's the same forces who murdered our heroes. It's the same forces who are after us right now. They're communists and they're liberal apologists. That's how it's always been. So if you work with those kids, usually nothing bad happens. If they're left alone, whether it's boys or girls, and I'm sorry, but they are really young, something stupid can always occur. For instance, they should have chased the guy away. They didn't. He showed up with his own equipment, burned the effigy, and they just stared at him. Yeah.
So I'm going to follow up on that. With it being a grassroots movement, have you seen any adoption of the methods done in Poland and any of the neighboring eastern states?
Oh, I think the Balts, because the Balts wanted to reconstruct their national identity, the Balts, the Estonians, Latvians, and Lithuanians pioneered very many things, but they did so from above. That is, to escape any accusations of collaboration with the Nazis, they constructed their glorious mythology of fighting against the Soviet occupation. So the Balts in the 1990s were already all over the place, putting up monuments and plaques, burying the insurgents, staging government-sponsored demonstrations. However, because in the Baltic states it was centralized as well as grassroots, because I'm not going to pretend that the Baltic governments were the initiators. The initiators were dissidents. When Gorbachev came to power, Estonian dissidents, especially historians, began collecting stories about the Gulag, about the insurgents. So they were the first. And then it was grassroots. Once they got in the government, they created a myth of resistance and symbol of resistance. So, yes, very much in the Baltics, you saw this, but only as anti-communism. In Poland, both anti-Nazism and anti-communism, against the Germans and against the Soviets, two enemies. In other countries, it's also problematic. For instance, the Simon Wiesenthal Center objected to the Romanians commemorating with a movie a Romanian insurgent leader, the one who was the last one to be caught, because as a teenager, he had been a part of the Iron Guard fascist youth group. Well, in Poland, you don't have problems like this because they were equal opportunity haters towards Nazis, and both Nazis and communists. In Romania, they just disliked the communists. There was not too much anti-German animus. Same story in the Carpathians with even on the Slovak side. Plus, you see now something that you have referred to in Slovakia, now a party which wears Hlinka guards uniforms, complete with the Roman salute, won 6% of the vote to the parliament, which is astonishing. They resurrected themselves as they had been back in 1938 or 44. So you don't have really much like this, just a couple of tiny groups like that in Poland. Mainstream soccer fans and other groups are not like that so far. But if the EU pushes them, if they feel again marginalized, which is not the case under the current government, who knows what shape such commemorations will take, because people tend to, or some people tend to, not so much remember as try to capitalize on a phenomenon for current political use, which is only natural, but that's what they do. I'm in the business of digging graves and resurrecting the fallen. Other people may be in the business of trying to capitalize on this, getting into parliament, or stoking fear, you name it. It can be this phenomenon can be channeled towards either evil or good. It all depends. It all depends. Any more questions? Yes, Mr. Chair.
I have a question of a detail about the PowerPoint presentation, the slide of the captured German Ferdinand artillery piece. On the bottom right, it looks like there's an insignia of a Polish Air Force insignia.
Yes, because of the website.
Oh,
no, you're talking about the tank?
On the tank.
Because sometimes Polish armor had the same insignia, the checkered board, right?
Checkerboard.
Sometimes the Polish tanks had similar insignia. Yes. So it was not solely the Air Force, because it's not the Air Force. You know what it is?
Cavalry.
Yeah, cavalry. Lancers and Hussars had the checkered pendants. So both armor and air force in Poland use them now as continuity. Any more? Yes, sir.
Yeah,
Is there a nationwide structure for these younger people to be organized, or are they spontaneous?
They hate organizations. So what they do is social media. They post on Facebook, they text, they tweet. Usually the hub of activities is a local soccer club. It's a local soccer club. And soccer fans tend to organize things, but not everywhere. For instance, in Piwa, it's a priest. And the priest used to be a soccer fan back in the 80s. He was one of the staunchest youthful anti-communist street fighters. Yes, I know him. He was with an underground group called Federation of Fighting Youth, Federacja Młodzieży Walczącej. He was in that with another kid, who's now not a kid anymore, Sławek Cenckiewicz, a leading historian in Poland. So you have local leaders, whether it's a priest or a teacher or someone like that, who remembers. And they start organizing locally and say, hey, the communists told us that all that matters is the center, so Moscow or Warsaw, and we have our own life in our little place, and here's who we are. And we have our heroes too, we just didn't know about it, and those of us who knew about it were scared to talk about anything. So what you see is, and that's a very positive phenomenon, a revival of localism and local self-government, because these people get organized themselves. They really usually have no money. Sometimes they'll go see a local businessman who will say, you know, I'm proud I'm from here, so here it is. Let's build them a grave. Let's remember. And our kids need role models. What do liberal media provide for us? Well, it's very simple. Extreme individualism or radical individualism and hedonism. So MTV. And look at this. The kids, instead of watching MTV, even when they sing rap songs, it's about positive heroes, people who were formidable. And guess what? Kids read about those things. Read, not just watch, but they read. And they're encouraged to strive despite all the adversity. And in my book, that's wonderful. Whom are they going to admire? Lenin and Rosa Luxemburg? You're kidding me? Shh. So they have their heroes. And we'll see what they'll do with them. Every fashion dissipates after a while. So they have to build on this and go somewhere else. As I said, nobody, not me, I don't think anybody of us who started working those vineyards. I was, of course, in California, so I had doomed soldiers in my neighborhood, and I had materials, pictures, and everything else, because in the emigre community, we keep those things. We keep the memories alive. But the people in Poland had nothing. Nothing. Just traumatized victims, families. I know of a case where a girl took first prize in a chemistry competition, and her reward was to be admitted to the best school, to enter a chemical program as a chemistry major. And then they found out what her last name was. The secret police intervened. She was told she was a daughter of a bandit, and she was kicked out. Oh yeah, if you want to talk about affirmative action, the communists had an affirmative action for themselves, and they're scum. Good people were tormented, physically and psychologically. Only when Solidarity blew up was the secret police no longer capable of handling everybody. So they let the remnant of the unslaughtered and their families alone. Except in many cases, the children and grandchildren of those people, of men and women of the underground, continued on against the communists in Solidarity. Hence, so many patriotic symbols in Solidarity. We're wondering about nationalism too, and religious symbols. So long as there is no war, and let us pray there is no war, or some kind of a revolution, everything should be fine. The scum will float away, and good people will assert themselves. All right. Thank you. I'll see you next time. I hope to be able to entertain you again.